Oh, hi. Welcome to the second part of the second part of the Design Fiction course. I am Mehmet Aydın Baytaş. I'm a postdoctoral researcher at Chalmers University of Technology in Interaction Design. As part of this course, I'm going to try to offer you some thoughts and resources for how you can utilize design fiction in design work. So in the previous video, we have discussed how we might utilize design fiction within strategic design and design research. And now in this part of the course, we're going to look at how exactly within design research, we can delineate and define the place of design fiction. So in this short lecture, I'm going to introduce you to the first of the three readings in this module, which is an excerpt from a book that I have found tremendously useful in understanding and navigating my own profession, which is, as you might have guessed it, design research. The reading that we're offering you is called Showroom, Research Meets Design and Art. This is chapter 6 in the book Design Research Through Practice by authors Ilpo Koskinen, John Zimmerman, Thomas Binder, Johan Redström, and Stefan Wensveen. So if you're already involved in design research, then I can bet that you've already heard the names of some of these people. All six of them, they are highly respected and very productive senior professors, experts in design research and interaction design. If you are involved in design research, or you would like to get involved, or you would like to advance your knowledge about design research, I actually highly recommend that you go online and you have a look at the work that these people are doing. You check out some of their other books and other papers and projects. So the reading that we chose for this course is chapter 6 in this book. This means that there are 5 more chapters that precede it. And in addition to that, the book itself has a particular context and purpose that it serves. In this video, I'm going to try to summarize some of this context and content so that when you read the chapter itself, it makes more sense to you. The book, as the title makes obvious, is about doing design research through practice or using design practice as a method of research. This kind of research is called constructive design research, or also known as research through design. Basically, what this means is that you're utilizing the acts of construction and creation, or as we discussed in the video previously, what we call tactical design, as a way of doing research and creating knowledge. Now, this book that I have is from the year 2011, but the idea of constructive design research, or research through design, is actually much older than that. In fact, one of the best-known resources where research through design is defined and distinguished from other activities related to both design and research is a paper from 1993 by the author Christopher Frayling, also a professor, and it's called Research in Art and Design. So this constructive design research, or research through design, is a hugely popular idea in interaction design research, and it has been described and developed through the works of many researchers and authors, including, of course, the authors of this book. Almost all of these works actually can be traced back to the 1993 paper by Frayling. I also personally think that this paper does a really good job of clearly describing the different kinds of design research that are possible to do, and understanding these different kinds of research will make your life easier when it comes to utilizing design fiction as a research tool. So I'd like to talk to you, first of all, a bit about the three forms of design research that Frayling is describing to introduce the content that will follow. So the reason we're actually talking about this is that when we talk about design research, there are a few different ways of doing that. Constructive design research, or research through design, is one of them. And within constructive design research, there are, again, a few different ways of doing that. So within those, there's one particular kind of constructive design research that is very compatible with design fiction. So to understand this context, or this lineage, or this tree of ideas, will give you a clear idea about the place of design fiction within design research, and by extension, within design practice. So the starting point of all of this, the origin of all of these ideas, if you go back to the paper by Frayling, is actually quite simple. As a designer and artist operating within the professional ecosystem of academic research as a professor in the university, what Frayling wants is to be taken seriously. So a lot of us, when it comes to research in natural sciences like chemistry or physics, or when it comes to social sciences like anthropology or sociology or economics, we do not have any trouble recognizing the worth and the value of these activities. And Frayling's argument is that research that goes on in art and design can be just as serious and just as valuable for the advancement of human civilization as the natural and social sciences. Of course, one of the steps that he has to take to establish the credibility and value of design research is to reach some clarity around how we even define design research. What are the particular kinds of design research that are possible? How do we judge them? What are the various standards of quality that we apply to these kinds of research? And this paper from 1993 is exactly a step in that direction. So what Frayling does here is that he talks about three different kinds of design research. First, he talks about research for design. This is what designers do when they are gathering information to guide their actual design decisions when they're working on a product or app or something. This is your interviews and ethnographies and mood boards. Then he talks about research in design, which is when design itself and designers themselves become a subject of research. Research in design is actually research about design and designers. And finally, research through design, and later called constructive design research, involves creating designs. It involves making things and then using these things as tools for knowledge creation. This is about finding out knowledge that would have been impossible to know otherwise without having created design artifacts in the first place. So an extremely simple example for a research through design activity could be, for example, a focus group where you bring in a new gadget, where you bring in your prototypes with various shapes and materials and sizes. And your participants in the focus group are able to touch and manipulate these things and provide feedback accordingly. Some of this feedback you will find would be impossible to obtain without having the actual prototypes. If you're able to show the actual design to people, if people are able to handle the actual design rather than just hearing about the concept, this opens up a lot of possibilities for feedback and collecting insights, which would not be available without the existence of the artifact in the first place. So to visualize these three possibilities for how design research might come to be, I would like to offer you three simple illustrations. So if we imagine design as a process that unfolds in time, research for design is research that is positioned inside the design process. This is the research that you do that is directly related to the purpose of your design. In some ways, this is an indispensable part of the design process. Without this research, you're not even doing actually design, you're just making pictures or models. This is that hugely important strategic aspect of design that we talked about in the previous video. Research in design, when you're looking at the design process from the outside. This is when you come in from the outside and try to find out about what's going on in there. For example, I know that Adobe, the software company, does a lot of this, where they look at the practices of designers that use, you know, the tools they make, which are Photoshop and Illustrator and all these other software. And by looking at these practices, they try to arrive at insights that will be embodied in the next product. Finally, research through design is when the design process becomes part of the research. This is when you have to go and create something, design something and make it real in order to answer your research question. For example, in my own research, I look at how we can best utilize gesture sensing and hand movements in a human body to interact with computers and robots and drones. These investigations would not be possible without actually building these interfaces and prototypes with actual sensors and computer vision and drones. This is what research through design, also known as constructive design research, is about. It's about creating new designs so that you can answer certain research questions and create knowledge that would be impossible to achieve without having those creations materialize in the first place. And that is exactly the topic of this book. The main question that they're looking at here is, how do you actually do constructive design research? What are some particular categories of constructive design research? How do we choose the kind of constructive design research to do in order to serve our purposes as professional designers or design scholars? How is constructive design research to be done? What are some examples? What are some criteria and standards for high quality constructive design research? So briefly, and very briefly, the book actually talks about three different kinds of constructive design research. And these are actually given away by the subtitle right here on the cover, These are the lab, the field, and the showroom. The lab approach is when you make something, an artifact, and then you bring in people to try out and use it and provide you with some knowledge that relates to your research questions. So this could be, for example, your usability studies and experiments and focus groups. This approach is actually closely related to how research is done in psychology, and it might involve quantitative research, numbers, and statistics. So the second approach, which has to do with being on the field, is relevant when you're working on a design that doesn't really make sense in a lab as a standalone artifact. To make sense, it has to be deployed out in the real world. It has to be there in a context of use. So for example, if you're going to do research on how people might approach giant screens in a bus stop, which might display ads or maps or something, it would make sense to actually go and deploy your prototypes in real bus stops. Sometimes the research questions that are at the heart of field research can involve human relationships and social aspects, rather than just plain old human-computer interaction where there's one user and one computer. If you're designing for an office, let's say, you might be doing a booking system or information display where it's a place where teams of people are working together. This system will affect the relationships between these people and how they work together. For this reason, this field approach is often related to sociology and anthropology. It is common to see research methods from social sciences, like ethnographies and qualitative analysis, being used in constructive design research done on the field. Finally, and this is where it comes together for us, the showroom approach is there to provide a foundation for design work that involves fiction and speculation. The showroom approach in constructive design research is the place where design fiction belongs. This is the tradition and discipline of design research that you have to understand if you're serious about utilizing design fiction in your work. So in this video, I will actually not go into a lot of detail about the showroom approach because it is important on your part to invest the time in consuming this chapter of the book and thinking about this content on your own. As I argued previously, the value of design fiction for the profession and scholarship of design is best realized when it is grounded in research. So to become proficient as creators and users of design fiction, it is important to cultivate your own research skills. And reading this chapter from the book itself thoroughly on your own time is a great start at doing that. I actually also think that this is a very well-written and informative text. It is a pleasure to read, and this was one of the reasons why we selected this to be part of the course. So please take your time, read through the chapter. It should take you around 15 or 20 minutes tops to get through. So to summarize what we've been talking about, in this particular part of the course, we're trying to understand and clearly describe the exact place of design fiction within design work. And we have already established that design fiction has the greatest potential to be valuable when it is used as a research activity. And now we've looked at some resources which define exactly what kind of research activity design fiction is. We looked at three different kinds of design research, one of them being research through design, also known as constructive design research. We then looked inside of constructive design research to discover that there are three distinct approaches or traditions: the lab, the field, and the showroom. And we saw that the home of design fiction within design research and within constructive design research is the showroom tradition. What exactly does showroom mean? How do we create, publish, exhibit, and evaluate design research within this tradition? What are some standards of quality that apply to design research within the showroom tradition? How does all of this link back to the practice and profession of design? All of these questions are discussed within Chapter 6 of Design Research Through Practice, and we will also return to these topics as we continue with the rest of this course.